If you look at the agenda, we're going to switch into the things you need section. And we're going to start with a one pager, which is not something you're going to see so much on the coastline or in the large VC deals. This is more of the, I'm looking for seed money, I'm looking for angels. I'm in the Midwest where they're not lined up and ready to go. This is something that we have found, and you've got a copy of this full size in your book, both slides. And if you ever want the template for this, you can get it. But it's really meant to be a public document. So first and foremost, talk to your attorney. Because there's rules around raising capital about what you can and can't say. And things do change. So what I remember from a few years ago is probably no longer accurate. But the trick, the thing you're trying to do is, let's say I'm trying to raise money for a startup in the volunteer space. And I know Kaylee over here, and I don't know if she's accredited or not, but I know she knows everybody in the volunteer space. I need something to send to her that she can send on to the people she knows. And it can't be a business plan. I had somebody send me a 68-page business plan the other day. I'm not going to read it. I don't know who you are. I've never heard of you. Now, if Kaylee sends it to somebody she knows, and it's a five-minute read, and it gives me an overview, I can, as an investor, that investor can make a decision. Am I interested or not? And so if you look at this document, it's basically, I thought I had it in the deck. I don't. So if you look at the two pages in your book, I apologize for putting them out of there somewhere. The first page, this is an actual company that was started many years back, probably five, six, 7 years ago. Nice looking document, looks professional. What this really is a five-minute business plan. This is the most succinct business plan you'll ever write in your life. And it's actually kind of hard to do. And I have people come to me and say, I want to write a business plan for my company. And it's like, great, write this first. Don't write five pages about marketing. Give me targeted market and customers in one paragraph. Be succinct. Because if you're going to get a meeting, you don't have more than 10 or 15 minutes anyway. So the summary of what you're doing, what's the problem you're solving, what are the products and services, this is pretty straightforward stuff. Why are you competitively advantaged? What's the point? Down on the left side, you're just going to see the basic information. They actually did a second page, and I'm not sure everybody needs to do this, but they're very proud of the team they had, so they talked about their team. But again, it's just, all it is something that I can forward on. If you said to me, I'm doing a deal in the ag space, and if I'm not interested in the ag deal, that's fine, but I might know some ag investors. I can't give them your name. I can't just say, here's all their contact information, have fun calling them. Those guys would never talk to me again. We don't want that kind of thing. But if I can send it out to 15 or 20 people that I know and say, hey, if you're interested, reach out to these guys. That could be a very effective tool. So again, it's not something that's typical in the VC world at all. It's not what you're going to do with a VC. You are going to use it with the angels, especially around the Midwest, especially where you're trying to find a group of angels to talk to or a group of seed investors. And again, it's just so that you can get a chance to talk to them and go present to them. So I do suggest you do this, not just because you need angels, because I'm going to tell you, it's really hard to do this in one page, yet it's exactly what you have to do. It's like a longer elevator pitch. Very succinctly explain all 10 aspects of your business. So there is it's just a simple three-column Word document. If you want the template, I'd be happy to send it to you. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it today, but take a look through this and think about, can you do this? Can you say this? Because we're going to get into the pitch deck next, and the pitch deck is probably more just a PowerPoint version of exactly this. And by the way, they better all match, okay? The worst thing in the world, and I'm going to point it out right now, but we see it over and over and over, is the financials that are on here, the financials that are in your pitch deck, the financials that you post on Gust, the financials that you present in your presentation, consistently they never match. And it drives me insane. As an investor, I'm just going to tell you, you lose your credibility. Now, if you walk in and say, by the way, I updated my financials, I changed three things, here are the three things. I'm like, cool, good, got it, you care. But if they're all different, why do you think I think you can manage my money? That'd be like your bank saying, yeah, I know your balance isn't right, don't worry about it. I got it. Come on, you'd never put up with it. So, any questions on this? Yeah.
I would just say, if you encouraged us to do this early on, this document, and then we kind of have a brief video of what we do. It's like a 2-minute pitch. By far, the two most kind of utilized resources or things that, actual investors look at and get clicked on. So we kind of track that, and you know, majority of them want to see the video and they want to see this, and they appreciate that you've taken 5 to 10 minutes of their time instead of an hour. So Mike had told me this 3 or 4 times before I actually did it, so I would just say go ahead and break down and do it.
And I will say this morphs into something you can use with business partnerships. When somebody says, do you have an overview of your company? Do you have something? If you have something like this in your pocket, ready to go at any moment, when somebody says, do you have something, you say yes and reply right there and say, here it is, and it looks impressive. If you already have it ready to go versus, well, I'll write something and get it to you. All right, Sharice, you're up again. You got a big 10-minute break. You're welcome.
All right, the pitch deck. Is this okay? Something I learned very early on is investors only listen for about 5 minutes. So you might get a 20-minute meeting, you might get an hour meeting with them, but their attention starts to go like this after about 5 minutes. So when you're developing your pitch deck, you really need to think through, how are you going to catch their attention? How are you going to hook them into wanting to listen for another 20, 30 minutes? Most investors hear, you know, 10 plus pitches a day, if not more. So thinking through, how are you going to stick out? How are you going to become interesting to them very early on in the conversation is important, because likely you're going to lose them. They might be very engaged in the first 5 minutes, and they might be on to working on their cell phone, trying to get a deal done, following up on something else. They're multitaskers, and you can't really take that personally. It's just knowing your audience, that they're not going to really stay with you always the entire conversation. I think the best pitches do get the investors really intrigued, to the point where it's not really going through your pitch deck, it's more of a conversation. If you can do that, you know you're kind of onto the right track, because you want them engaged, not just doing the thing, which is, you know, sitting there politely for 30 minutes or so. There's a lot of different philosophies in what should be in your pitch deck. And I went online and I pulled out a couple known investors. Dave McClure does a lot of 500 startups, the early venture deals. So his kind of decks and advice are geared a little bit more towards some of the earlier stages. Sequoia Capital, one of the very large VC firms out in the Valley, and they have kind of a specific, we want to see these 11 or so slides. Airbnb, I really liked their pitch deck. They have about 12 slides. And as you can see, each one has common elements, and I would, you know, encourage you to pull through what are the common elements that everyone has. And then knowing your audience, okay? If you're going to Sequoia, you probably should go on their website and match what their deck expectations are. I've had some VCs say, tell me about your team right away. They want that the first thing. They want to know who they're talking to. I've had another VC, I don't care who I'm talking to. Show me what your product is. Tell me why I should care. I don't care about you. That's probably not the investor that I wanted to be on my board. But I say that to say that there's very stark opinions about sometimes the way they like things done. And oftentimes, if they have very strong opinions, you can find that on their blogs. They'll blog about, these are the way that we like to see decks. If not, these are some of the slides that I would encourage you to consider and encourage you to make it your own. The pitch deck really should be conversational and flow like a story. rather than, okay, here's this pitch, I'm reading it. You want to be comfortable telling your story, and that comes through, I think, with an excitement when you're comfortable with the flow of how your pitch is situated. So with that said, there's no magic playbook. Like, you put these 11 slides in, you follow this advice, you're gonna get the money. It doesn't quite work like that, but hopefully these are good pointers. I've used Google over the years to find some really great pitch decks. Sometimes it's hard to start from scratch, and you know your business so well, sometimes boiling it down into 11 slides is really difficult. I found Googling pitch decks and looking through examples have provided me guidance over the years of, oh, I like the way that they told that story. I think I could tell my story in a similar way, in the way that they used data, the way that they used market projections, the way that they got people excited about their problem. If you're, you learn well by other examples, there's tons of them out there. I would suggest, though, don't copy them verbatim. Just switching your name and your key facts. Like if you take Airbnb and just put your stuff in it, it's probably not going to go over real well with an investor. They're probably going to see through like, that looks like Airbnb's pitch deck. So you have to be original and make it your own. In addition to the pitch deck, there's some additional information that is often requested, after that first meeting. So you go in and you pitch, and they like what you're talking about. Oftentimes they'll ask for some more market data, compelling metrics. Do you have a dashboard that you track that shows what your compelling metrics are? Those might be into how many website clicks do you get and what's your sales funnel look like. Those are not things that you would put in your pitch deck unless it's like the key driver. But having those as backup slides, if asked, and you could turn those around quickly, are usually a good idea. Customer examples. If your product is maybe a little hard to wrap their head around, I think a customer example can help the investor really think, okay, what is this use case? What does your customer really look like? If you're able to do that in a couple of slides, that's usually a good follow-up slide to have as well. Who are your top 10 customers? There's some VCs that they want to know who your customers are. They want to have had heard of them. They might want to call those customers. So you have to be careful with when they ask who your top 10 customers. And I always ask, this is confidential list. If you're going to follow up with any of your customers as references, I would like to, prepare them first. So there's a little bit of best practice in when you give customer lists out, that it's assumed to be confidential, but you want to make sure that that's clearly articulated. They may ask for customer references. Of course, in that instance, you want to call your customer and say, hey, can I use you as a customer reference? They're explaining your product. There are some investors that they invest pretty much on, do they like your product? Do they like the technology? So being able to describe your product and technology in more in depth is often really helpful. Some of your companies, you could just say, hey, go to the website, sign up for an account, play around. Other companies, that's not possible for them to really get a flavor for the actual technology. Videos, like you said, demos can, and tape demos can often be really beneficial to send as follow-up to investors. And then your financial review and sales funnel. I've never pitched my financials in that first meeting. It's usually a follow-up piece that would be shared once you get a little bit further down the process. You want to be able to speak to the high-level key points of your financials. But no one's gonna, be like, let's dig into your spreadsheet in that first meeting. I also use my financials as a little bit of a gate. I've used this as a gating process to make sure that they're really engaged before I send out my company's financials. I would encourage in entrepreneurs not to send your financials to 20 different VCs. I mean, they should be pretty far in the process.
before you send them, send your financials. And I also like to set up a specific meeting just to go through the financials so that they aren't misinterpreted, that you get the opportunity to talk through them. That's why, you know, a slide really doesn't give you adequate time to get into the depth of your financials.
If I could just share a quick story with that. I've had a VC forward me the financials, very detailed financials of a competitor, and asked me to poke holes into it. So that's definitely a good reason to do what you just suggested.
Right, right. Yeah, you know, VCs are supposed to have a code of conduct where they don't share your information, but there's not always the best practices. So knowing that, especially if you're in a competitive space, that's essentially your plan, right? You don't want that all over the world. Okay.
That, I will say that happens more than you want to believe it happens.
Okay, so we go back. I don't know if I caught what you meant by sales funnel.
Sales funnel. So depending on what stage of company, what life cycle you're in, a lot of investors will say, show me your sales funnel. What does your sales funnel look like? Do you have 100 leads? Are 20 of them warm? Are 5 of them closed? Are 5 of them in the last stage? So kind of knowing what does the life cycle of a customer go through in order for you to close them. And they'll often, investors are kind of asking for that data to see, okay, am I investing and then you're gonna start your sales and marketing effort? Or do you already have traction? Are there already customers, you know, 100 customers, 1,000 customers that are being touched that could lead to those sales and revenue in the first couple months after their investment? Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, early on, it might not be sophisticated. It might be an Excel sheet. These are the 100 contacts that we have, and here's their name, and, you know, this is the next step of
talking to. But it needs to be more detailed than, you know, broad segmentations.
Yeah, they're wanting to see some data, you know, or if you need to close 20 customers in the next month, you should probably already need to have 40 to 50 in the sales funnel, likely. And that's a piece, though, you need to be careful. Earlier on in the process, I usually abstract the number and not tell them the name of the companies, because again, you don't want to give out potentially competitive information early on in the process.
Do you have a preferred way to share kind of this additional information on Dropbox, or is there some tool out there that's really good for?
Mm-hmm. Sometimes it depends of where you're at in the process. Early on, email is usually, you know, quick for an investor to say, just email me that attachment over. As you get further on, setting up a Dropbox or a box to share with them. Through my experience, everyone might do it differently. I like to be a little bit further along in the process before I open up a box with someone or a Dropbox. I also would suggest tools like Box or Dropbox that are pretty industry standard. Most people can get access to them. Most people have used them before. There's some proprietary, you know, software out there. What you're going to find is your investor doesn't want to sign up for yet another login, another service. So Box and Dropbox, Google Drive are a little bit more the commonplace services. Okay, your pitch deck, going back to telling a compelling story, your pitch deck really should be, you know, in story format. And I was reading a blog once of an investor who doesn't even read the slides, he just reads the headlines and wants to kind of get a feel for the company. And he might take the first meeting based on that, a quick overview of just the headlines. So that's something to think through. Like, are you being catchy in the way that you structured your deck? Is it telling some, you know, are you able to flow through it and be like, oh, I get what this company is up to? The other thing, there's nothing wrong with your solution, with your slide saying problem, solution. You know, being very straightforward of what you're talking about also helps guide the conversation. I liked this example. You know, when you have the opportunity to create a catchy headline, I think you should. Instead of saying team, if you can say right mix of passion and experience, that's catchy. You know, that tells a little bit more story than here's my team. Again, you have to figure out though what works works for you? What seems natural when developing it? I also would suggest, people get so sick of hearing about how you're so disruptive and how you're so innovative. These are huge buzzwords. You know, if you can explain your company in other ways and not always using those big buzzwords, I think it has a bit more credibility. And lastly, you know, figuring out how to use your voice. And this is why going on the internet, finding a deck and then copying it doesn't really work, because it's not your voice. It's not how you tell the story of your company. On the problem slide, the goal of the problem slide is really to nail down what pain point are you solving for your customer? And you want to explain the pain point in a way that's compelling and that someone's going to buy into, hey, that's a problem that needs a solution, not an idea that you go try to find what's the problem around my idea. It should be the other way around. I also think that this is a critical piece. If you can't convince an investor that something's truly broken, I think you're going to have a hard time getting an investment.
Sorry, one question on this is, if your focus on just what you might feel is the main pain point, because I'm thinking there's probably 3 to 4 that our business would mm-hmm. try to solve,
uh-huh.
but is that diluted by?
Is there a way you can describe that in a way, you might say, we solve, I don't know your business, so complex reporting problems in the X space. How you do it might be 3 to 4 pain points. But you want to try to abstract it to like a sentence without getting into the details, you know?
Okay.
And then you can talk through that, like, this is how we do that, or these are multi-layer pain points. But the challenge really is pulling that up to one sentence.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, it's really hard for me to talk about it abstractly without knowing your business, but.
Yeah.
Yeah. I found some great decks too online that give you an example of like, here's a large case study and this is how they boiled it down into a problem statement. If you're getting stuck, it might be a suggestion that helps for you. Or talking to other people, right? If you're so enthralled in your business that you might not be able to explain it in this kind of 50,000 view. But as you talk to some people, they might say, you're explaining it in a lot of detail, but really you're saying this. Is that what you're trying to say, Greg?
Well,
and you might be like, yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Okay.
It's you have to boil it up. Which can be challenging. This is a slide, and we're sending out an email with some links to some of these decks. But I like the way that this deck tries to weave a story into the problem slide. And this slide deck specifically is one of the first slides in their deck. And what they do well is 215 billion emails. If I'm an investor, I'm like, wow, that right there, that's huge. You know, without even knowing what this business is, this deck is painting the picture of a big market opportunity. And they're using data points then to really explain what the problem is. Here's an example of, but email is a tool designed for personal use. So I think creatively, the way that they've demonstrated what the problem is a really interesting and catchy way to talk through their problem. When you're thinking through the solution slides, again, it's sometimes natural to get into the technology or get into the nitty-gritty of what you've created. But really what you want to try to do is talk through how you solve the pain point through the solution. It's easy to get into the shiny object of like, this is my technology, this is why it's great, you know, and think through like, here's my product solution. But you want to keep saying, okay, so bringing that back to what pain point are you solving through your solution, and weaving that storyline into the way that you talk through your problem and solution. What's the pain? What's the pain that you're alleviating? Like it may be a very abstract, a Band-Aid. You know, you wouldn't want to say, and here's the Band-Aid. It has this really, you know, nice sticky piece and this really wonderful wrapper, and here's a piece of gauze. You know, this is a wonderful Band-Aid. Well, okay, but what does the Band-Aid solve, right? Talk about what it solves, not the Band-Aid itself. This is a competitive landscape example. And it's a little hard to see on the screen, but I think it's nicely done in the sense of really, this is the pitch deck front, that they're in the upper right-hand corner. And one of my board members always said, show me why you're in the upper right quadrant. Show me how you compare to the other competitors in the landscape. And the reality is, it's sometimes easy when you're creating a new business to say, I have no competitors, I'm so new. I don't compete with anyone. I'm a new market segment. That's probably not the case. Most companies that I've seen always have competitors. And it's going to challenge you to think, who are your competitors and how do you compete with them? I think the thing also in competitive landscape is you want to be really thoughtful about who's in the market, who could be competing with you. There's nothing worse than an investor saying, hey, have you heard of XYZ company? I saw them pitch last week and they look like you. And you're like, huh? Who are they? You know, especially the further along you go. It's pretty embarrassing to not know who's in your space and to be surprised by an investor. And there's nothing wrong with having a lot of competitors. You know, sometimes you think, oh, I don't compete with a lot of people, therefore I'm gonna be more appealing. That's not necessarily the case. Having competitors and being able to map out why you're different, why you're gonna win, is a good thing. Product lineup. One thing that I have experienced throughout my years is the coastal VCs seem much more interested in knowing what you're going to build from a product and technology standpoint than maybe local investors. So think through that when you're pitching and developing your storyline. What does your audience care about? I had a couple investors say, you know what, I'm not really too interested in your pitch deck. I just want a product demo. Can we just spend 20 minutes going through your product? And coming up with a product roadmap is important because it also helps them understand how are you prioritizing what you're going to build? What are you going to build next? How are you going to compete in the marketplace? I think this slide does a really nice job kind of breaking it down into quarters. And what they're planning on building with the money that they're bringing on. Business model. Important pieces in your business model to demonstrate in your pitch deck. Often, you know, what is your pricing? What does your revenue model look like? And back to, it's okay if you don't completely know. But you should know what you're leading with, what your starting point is. It might change over time. But give an idea of how you're thinking about it to start with. There's things like lifetime value. An investor might say, what's your LTV? The first time I asked that, I was embarrassed. I didn't know what LTV meant. Lifetime value of your customer is something that you should figure out. It might change. But knowing, kind of going in, hey, I think my LTV is going to be $100,000. That's a good number to go in with in your pitch. Thinking through, how are you going to distribute your product?
What's your sales model? Are you going to have channel partners or are you not? Are you going to sell direct? Are you going to sell online? Are you going to have an outbound sales force? Are you going to have a inbound marketing sales force strategy? You know, how are you thinking about it? Again, it might evolve, but what's your starting point as of that conversation with the investor?
On some of these kind of business model metrics, you know, like in the software as a service world, there's kind of some benchmarks out there. How important, I guess there's a lot of those metrics, and every week there seems to be a new one. Everybody says, oh no, this is how you measure a SaaS business. And so sometimes we're trying to figure out, okay, what are the two or three that every investor is going to sort of be able to get their head around? Any thoughts on that? I mean, you guys were in that.
Yeah, the three of the four that I remember constantly being asked was MRR, what's your monthly recurring revenue? What's your CAC, customer acquisition cost? LTV, lifetime value. Those are actually the main three that I got asked consistently over and over and over. I also, you know, I started to figure out which investors invest in SaaS companies, and going on and reading their blogs, the metrics that they're talking about in their blogs over and over and over, or is a good indication about what they care about. Each industry has slightly different nuance of what they care about, so figuring that out. SaaS covers a lot of technology companies anymore. I feel like they all have kind of a software as a service component. So those are, you know, three to four good metrics to know. Did you experience others?
Yeah, no, those are the three that I would say we get asked a lot. And, and then there's other people that want to get the referral channel.
Churn rate is another one that would consistently come up. Early on, that's where you just have to be very honest to say, you know, we've only been in the market 12 months. My churn rate is, you know, 10%, but we don't have, enough history to really say, is that going to be what it operates at? There's some of the things that I would use to show that we were thinking through it was industry metrics. So I would say, hey, the industry metric for churn is roughly around 10%, and that's our goal. Historically, based on what we know so far, we think we're going to meet or beat that number. And that's the benchmark that we're using. Around CAC, I would go online and Pacific Crest, I don't know, Pacific Crest is an investment bank. They have a great survey, a software as a service benchmarking survey that they do every year. And so I would try to point my data towards the benchmarks. Again, it shows that you might not know yet, but you're thinking through how you're going to benchmark, and you're thinking through and being very aware of what successful companies look like, and that's kind of your goal. Does that help?
Yeah, no, that's great.
And then the team side. I would, highlight key experience. And you want to think through what's relevant, that Brian went to XYZ college and studied economics and, then had a job at Principal, may or may not be relevant. By the way, that's none of his background. but you want to pull out the relevant pieces. If you have a really short slide, if one of your founders has great industry knowledge in that funnel, highlight that. That's what the investor is going to care about. If you have an entrepreneurial background where you've started 10 businesses and had successful exits, that's probably what they care about more than where you went to college or what you studied. So just be really thoughtful. You have limited words that you can use in these slides. Also, don't be afraid to admit that you have holes. One of the stories I like to tell is an investor said, well, you don't have this type of individual. And I said, no, that's why we're raising money to be able to hire that individual. We didn't have VPs on our team, and we needed the next round of capital to go build out that team. And being very aware of that's what you're going to do and that's where your hole is shows
So it shows focus and it shows that you have a clear path of what you're missing. For the financials, you know, the financials piece I kind of hit on really aren't a bit large part of your deck. Your financials, in my opinion, should just give kind of an overview of what you're looking to accomplish and kind of what your key metrics are. But you do need to have a financial model ready to go when asked and when appropriate time. Typically, I like to see a 5-tab financial model that's really clean and simple. If you're not the best at Excel, there's people that can help you build a financial model. And if you get help having someone build it, I think that's fine. You just need to be able to navigate it yourself really, really well. Traction. That's a huge, huge part of getting someone excited. And everyone can demonstrate traction in different ways. It might be user growth, it might be sales, it might be major development releases, it might be industry news. Figure out what traction you have in your startup and the best way to demonstrate that. Data doesn't lie. Data is a little less subjective. So if you have data that shows traction, I think that it's a good idea to include it. You may not be at the point where you have data that you can share, and that's where you have to get a little bit more creative of how you share the traction story. Okay, and wrapping up your pitch, you should really plan to get through the pitch in about 20 minutes and then leave enough time for conversation, questions. And I've said this, you know, multiple times, the best pitch meetings really feel more like a conversation than a pitch. How's everyone doing? A lot of information, right? All right, we're gonna keep moving. Getting to the ask and initial terms. Be consistent in your ask. I've seen this mistake over and over and over where entrepreneurs start talking to VCs and they're not clear and they might say, hey, I'm looking to raise $5 million. Then they talk to another VC and they say, I think I'm gonna raise $10 million. And then fast forward, maybe they're having a really tough conversation, and then they talk to another VC and say, I'm asking $2 million. The world becomes really small, and oftentimes those VCs might be in a country club together, they might go running together, they might be on a board together, they might be co-invested in another company together. And all of a sudden they start to say, hey, did you hear about XYZ company? What their idea sounds really interesting. Oh yeah, they told me they were gonna raise $10 million. I bet they're gonna have a lot of problems raising $10 million. The other guy goes, oh, they told me they were raising $2 million. When did you talk to him? Oh, last week. When did you talk to him? Oh, about a month ago or 2 weeks ago. I mean, right there, that unfolds. Like, that's not gonna suit you well in trying to get your deal done. It's a challenge, though, as the entrepreneur, because you're out there trying to adjust to what the market's saying. You go out and $2 million, oh, that's not big enough. You should go bigger, okay? So then you up to $10 million, and then you hear, oh, that's too big. No one's ever gonna invest in you. So then you say, maybe $5 million. So you're reacting to the investor pool. And it's easy to see how that happens, but you want to try to be really methodical beforehand so that doesn't happen. Some key things that I've seen work is start some of those investor conversations and do what I call soft circling before you throw out numbers. Say, you know, we're out talking to the market. We're out gauging interest. What size of deals are you doing right now? And you don't always have to go in with the initial ask right away in the first meeting, especially if you don't know. And once you're clear,
I suggest sticking to what you said you were, you know, what you got clear on, because the market talks. If it's a different story every single time, you're likely going to get in trouble. Did you ever had any of that experience?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, when we first started thinking about raising our initial kind of seed, we weren't even sure what type of investment we wanted to take. So we, you know, kind of went out in the marketplace and talked to a lot of people and probably got folks sort of riled up and then stepped back and did a convertible note with a handful of strategic investors. And so in a small town like Des Moines or just even the Midwest, sort of calling all those folks and resetting and saying, well, we're not going to do a price round yet because, you know, in our case, we're a SaaS company and we feel like these metrics that, you know, we were talking about, we need to work on that first. I don't know. It was good for us to reset. I'm glad we kind of did that. But again, a lot of the investors talk to each other, so it is important to have kind of a really clear message about what stage you're at, what you want to invest.
I think we've seen, too, to that point of just hypothetically outraising capital, multiple versions of business plans and decks out there. So you're starting to have those hypothetical conversations, or you've been having that conversation for 6 to 12 months. We talk a lot of times, or, you know, somebody said they're raising this, or they're doing this, or doing this, and then there's like 3 or 4 other versions of plans out there or decks out there. So be very careful of what you're circulating, because it gets around, even in this community, with regard to the investment deals.
And I would add one other thing. If you're not sure you're going to raise capital, don't start the discussions and ask about raising capital. We've had people come to Plains Angels Supply, come in and pitch. We want to proceed as a group. And they say, well, we set up Prisma. Okay, so wasted a lot of people's time.
That's right.
Sure you said, we're out checking the market. We're thinking about it. That's fine. Happy to talk to you. Mm-hmm. We're probably not going to have you come and present Plains Angels for 20 minutes as one of two companies if you're just thinking about it. We're happy to talk to you. So if you're not ready to present and pour money and take a check, don't say you're raising money. Say you're looking at the market or thinking about it or getting ready. That's fine.
I also think there's people who want to lead a round, and then there's people who want to participate in a round where the terms have already been established. And it's really important if you're, you know, going to those people that you want to fill out your round, they don't lead rounds, know that, right? Don't go to them. And again, we kind of learned that lesson. Don't go to them if they're not going to be leading a priced round, if you haven't got your kind of lead investor in term sheet. Because a lot of the angel groups especially, they kind of want to have you come in and say, well, you know, we've got our lead investor, here are the terms of the deal, and kind of give it up or down vote if they're in or out. Whereas, you know, if you don't have that, I don't know. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sometimes the most important answer is no when you're talking to potential investors as well. You know, to that point, if it's somebody that wants to wait till you have a lead or whatever. So it's making sure you're having the right conversation with the right investors at the right time.
Brian, did you have a comment? Or are you stretching? All right. JD?
How about everybody get up and stretch for a second? Everybody stand up for a second. Wake me up a little bit because we're going to talk financials.
Everybody's favorite topic.
No, we're not going to be too detailed on them, but I'm JD Genezer. I'm a senior partner with LWBJ Capital Advisors. We're an investment bank, a consulting firm, and a CPA practice. I work with a lot of early stage companies, getting them ready to raise capital and taking them through the capitalization process. I actually worked with Ben Mellon originally, and then Charisse on the early stage raises with Dawala, and I was on the board of directors with Dawala. Gonna cover a little bit about some of the financials and some of the stuff you're gonna need to have as you go forward. And gonna begin with cap tables. We've done actually a half a day session on cap tables. So there's a lot of complexity into it, and we're not gonna show you any templates on it, but there's really, you know, a lot to be discovered through cap tables. But the important thing is it's a documentation of who owns what of your business. Whether you've had, you know, common shares or units if you're an LLC, preferred shares, rounds of financing, if you've got any employee incentives like options or warrants out there, and then even prices that may be paid by stakeholders. Maybe you've already had a seed round or a Series A round, and it just really, it's documenting that flow of investment coming through and the dilution impact of either the founders to the seed round to the Series A round. Very important to have a cap table current at all times, and I'll even preface this. I mean, the last piece it is required in diligence, and it can be just a stop the game situation if you don't have an updated current cap table. But the important thing about it too, as an owner, it allows you to run multiple scenarios to say, if I'm going to raise money and I'm going to set the pre-money valuation of my business at this, I'm going to raise this much. How dilutive is it to the existing investors? Or if I want to look at the amounts of different size of financing, if I'm going to raise $1 million, $2 million, what if I just raise $500,000? If you've got a good structured cap table, it allows you to run all those scenarios. Further, it allows you to take a look at maybe if you want to start to create some option pools and incentives for employees or key hires down the road, what's that look like if you build that into your capitalization charts? Again, required during investor diligence, have it in order. Same thing, you know, illogical order, not properly documented. It just can slow down the investment process. And then tailor the cap table to all the supporting documents. You're probably here if you haven't already heard as well. And Chris and Charisse touched on it a little bit of what we always tell everybody that comes in that wants to raise capital is, I want to know who their attorney is, and I want to understand that all their corporate documents are in a good position right now. I've got one right now that actually will work with Brown Winnick on, where it's a gentleman that has done a lot of right things, but he doesn't have anything papered. He's got an advisor, he's got an investor from outside the state that supposedly owns 40%, but he also owes the investor all the money back that the investor put in. None of it had been papered. And so it's very important to hire a good attorney for this raise process, but also have everything cleaned up with regard to your corporate documents, shareholder agreements, operating agreements that all tie back into your cap table. That's really quick. We're gonna talk a little bit this afternoon about just the cap table from a perspective of pre-money valuation and some of the things associated with the term sheet. Financial forecast. Own your forecast. We're talking about it a little bit. It's your responsibility. I'll tell you a really quick story that Chris Sackett talked about, an individual that blamed their CFO because they were out of money. She fired me 2 years prior to running out of money. Simply because we advised her that the lease payment on her 7 Series BMW probably didn't run in line with trying to run and grow a business. So I got a call 2 years later that she was trying to raise capital because she was out of funds. We decided not to take that. But it's own your financial. Don't blame other people for it. Take the time, realistic, detailed forecast. Grounded in assumptions and understand those assumptions, understand what's driving it. Maybe it's the metrics, maybe we're gonna talk about revenue and expense, but other assumptions that are driving. Generally, we'd like to do a 3 to 5 year forecast. Your first 12 months are the most important. How are you gonna get to the first 12 months? An investor coming in is gonna say, okay, I get that. They're gonna throw away 3 and 5 and just say, okay, let me understand how you're gonna get to what you tell me you're gonna do in the next 12 months. Revenue assumption. One thing that should be on here, I call pipelines, Therese called sales funnel. Show me your pipeline. Show me your assumptions to get to revenue. How are you going to distribute it? But what's the target market, the segments, and show me how you're going to convert your pipeline. Obviously, if you have paying customers, that's a huge external validator right there. And we can understand how you're going to extrapolate that. Know who's making the purchasing decision. Know your distribution model. A lot of times we work with companies that don't understand if they're going to sell direct or indirect, and how they're going to get their product out there, or even who's making the purchasing decision. So you really got to understand that. And then it's very important, obviously, again, if you have paying customers, your pricing model probably has been validated. But otherwise, is there research? What supports the fact that you're going to charge what you're going to charge for your products and services? Expense assumptions. Two main things. One of them that Casey brought up that Charisse, I don't know if you mentioned, is too, know your gross margin. Know what it's costing you to serve that revenue. By that, I mean, if you're manufacturing widgets, what's it cost you to make that widget? If you're a software company, what's it cost you to support that revenue? Maybe it's data cost, data storage cost. maybe it's onboarding or support costs going on. What is your margin to sustain that business, particularly if it's reoccurring business? People want to understand what that margin is for that continuation of that business. Cost to sell, customer acquisition costs, very important. Part of the cost to sell process as well is, what's your sales cycle? When you get somebody into your sales funnel or pipeline, is it a 9-month conversion? Is it a 30-day conversion? What's that sales cycle look like? What's that sales cycle require? How many touch points is that sales cycle? That's all part of cost in selling. Operational costs, again, your salaries, your G&A, your insurance costs, know them. When we work with a lot of people that put a model together, and it could be in an industry that requires extensive insurance coverages. Oh, I didn't think about that. Know your business and know what other expenses and costs are going to be to run that business. Capital expenditures. Again, capital expenditures don't necessarily run through your profit and loss statement, but you might need to buy a bunch of equipment. You might machinery. It could be further product development too. You've got to go and take the development of the technology product to the next level. You need $500,000 to do that. Know that spend and know what that's going to cost you. Cash flow. Cash flow is totally different than a P&L or a balance sheet. We work with a lot of companies creating a cash flow. They should be 6 months. This says 60 days, at least as you need it really granular. But what it is simply as, beginning this month, my cash balance is this. Here's all the inputs of cash I've got coming in. Revenue, hopefully, maybe it's financing, but here's all the actual true cash expenditures we're gonna make this month, and then that's what I'm gonna end the month at. I'm gonna snake that up, and that's gonna be my beginning balance of the next month. I'm gonna go through the whole cycle again, and you should have at least a good 6-month look at what your cash requirements are. Cash doesn't always necessarily follow your P&L. And being able to obviously know those requirements is very, very important, particularly if you're bringing in any type of institutional investor and any Series A round, they're gonna require that you know what your spend is, what your burn is. Again, spend wisely, be thrifty, find creative ways to bring resources in, maybe delay hiring, and a very important one is, particularly very early stage, if we have one right now, candidly, that we're working with, one of my other partners are working with, and the founder owner wants a $300,000 a year salary. Deal stopper. So he had raised other rounds, and that's what he's currently drawing on. So, I mean, investors are going to look at that. So, there's ways to manage cash until you get to certain points. Be wise. And then from a creative way, it's not always just necessarily giving equity to people, but maybe it's delaying hiring or finding other ways to actually, utilize resources where you don't bring on full-time equivalents. 60 days, really granular. You should really know, obviously, exactly what your spend's gonna be the next 60 days and then be able to extrapolate. Maybe you're gonna hire more people, whatever. But it's really, again, documenting your cash burn. That was really quick, but because you guys are hungry. Any questions? Kind of already covered a lot of that.
I have a question. Is it important to bring out the costs associated with running the business versus the cost that you spend to advertise your product, like marketing? Like when you talk about knowing your gross margin, so how much money does it cost to run the company to get the revenue that we saw? Yeah. Is it important to break out, like, but we spent $10,000 on an ad campaign?
Well, to me, that's part of your cost. That's a metric that may drive your customer acquisition costs. But yeah, you should certainly, I mean, a normal profit and loss and income statement is such that you've got your revenues and you've got basically what's called cost of goods sold, which really that's not your operational cost. A lot of times not marketing cost or even commissions. It's truly your cost to either build that or to support that revenue. You should always have that. Then all your, if you will, SG&A is basically selling general and administrative expenses. So they can be classified as marketing costs, but the point being is you should have other metrics beyond your financial statements to show, okay, here's what that cost per acquisition was, or here's what the spend was on a per, we have clients that actually do, obviously, even a capital expenditure per employee, what they're going to buy computers, they got to buy desks, all of that, that necessarily doesn't flow through P&L, but it's another metric they're tracking. So the gross margin is very, very important to understand. I mean, if you're selling something that you're losing money on, or you don't have a significant enough margin on, you're priced too high, or you're spending too much on it, right? And you want to make sure it's a sustainable model. But yeah, you should always be able to, you need to know if those marketing costs are directly tied to customer acquisition, you should be able to analyze that and report off of that on a customer cost.
Cool.
Another entrepreneur suggested that we consider including the amount of hours spent building a software product as an asset, so something that's kind of tucked onto your balance sheet. Whether it's the amount of software development that's gone in, maybe it's sweat equity. Can you just talk more about that?
I love putting it in a deck. I don't put it on the financial statements. A lot of times we'll deal with owners or founders that have spent $250,000 of their own funds developing the product, et cetera. And that's a lot of times capitalized as product development and all of that. It just kind of depends what your industry and how you treat it, whether it's an expense or not. Those do flow through. I love, it's very subjective to be able to, somebody tells me they spent 1,500 hours on it. Well, that's great. I mean, they're spending a lot of time on it. But it's really usually not something that should be recorded on your books, in other words. One other thing I'll add to that as far as, because we see a lot of it too, is owners coming in or founders coming in and they will have put money into the business, $200,000, $300,000. And that's sitting on their balance sheet as a note that the owner or the founder wants to have paid back in financing. That's a deal stopper as well. And it's amazing how times we see it. I put a line of credit on, I borrowed money and, once I get this, eventually I want to have my money paid back, but you're asking other people to come in and invest in you. And so you got to be careful how all of that's even presented. And again, like Chris said, think like an owner.
All right.
Thanks.
So I'm all that stands between you and lunch.
I always like being in this position.
I'm not.
All right, online platforms. This is a big part of the world of raising capital right now. And it's becoming more so every day. So basically, there's three or four platforms out there that matter. I would say the two that you really have to do, if you're at all serious about this, you need to be on Gust, you need to be on AngelList. And if you haven't found AngelList, it's one of the best places to figure out if you've got competition, because everybody's out there. I had a client come in and say, I'm gonna do XYZ, and he laid out exactly what he's gonna do, and nobody does this. He was a little arrogant about it. And so I pulled up a browser window and typed three or four of his key terms into AngelList and immediately found 18 startups doing almost the exact same thing. So it's embarrassing for that guy. If you were raising capital, that'd be a bad place to be. So going through these, it is part of your resume and identity. It's your LinkedIn in a lot of ways. If you want to apply to Plains Angels, you need to be in Gust. You want to apply to Gopher, Gust. Stateline, Gust. Gust, nobody likes it, okay? It's not the world's greatest platform, but everybody's on there. And once you've done it once, you do it for Plains Angels, you can invite Gust with a click. You can invite Nebraska with a click, and it's very secure. It's a very secure platform. And once you get over the nuances of it, it's fine. But don't fight this. Don't call me and tell me, well, I won't put my stuff in that system. Fine, don't apply. Our committee that reviews deals doesn't meet physically. We do it over email and Gust. All those documents are locked away, they're secure, we don't worry about it. We can actually leave comments out there, we can add our own documents out there and everybody can see it. So don't take us back to the 1970s. We're not gonna do it for you. So just know that. It's a place for your documents to live and show that you actually have them all. It's a recruiting tool, there's no doubt about it. Especially like AngelList, people are looking for a cool place to work, might find your profile and go, wow, I'd really like to work there. That's pretty neat. I have the experience you need. It is a fundraising tool and it's a single point of data room dissemination. So Gust especially, you can set up all your documents out there if you want and go through Gust. Gust does a pretty darn good job of making sure the people that are out there are supposed to be out there as far as accreditation, that type of thing. There's no guarantees, but it's really gonna help you a lot to if someone says, expose your documents to non-accredited investors? Well, I followed these things, I did these things. Okay, they're good practices, and most people know that. So Gust, a lot of pitch events use Gust. State here uses it, the Iowa Innovation Corp uses Gust. I saw Jenica smile about it, because she loves it as much as I do. You do have control to your data. So if you apply to Plains Angels and we say we don't want you to present, you don't meet our criteria, you can take it away from us. Just go out and say, I've pulled my application, and you have that control. So you're not out of control on your data. I will warn you, and I've got the last point here, it's not trivial. And notoriously, one of the guys on Plains Angels is Tej Dewan, and a lot of you may know Tej, and he's one of the few people I know that's more detail-oriented than I am. And if your numbers don't match up, it's really unlikely you're gonna pitch Plains Angels. If the revenue in your business plan has nothing to do with the revenue in the financials you turned in, which has nothing to do with the revenue in your pitch deck, I'm sorry, we're not inviting you to present. You're wasting our time. So don't underestimate this, and don't just shove out whatever you're thinking of. Have somebody go through it. People like me exist will actually do that for you if you ask. Hey, would you go through it and look at it with me? I'm happy to do that. But this is, you know, investing 101. Do your numbers tie off? Does your marketing tie off to your marketing spend? I'll look at somebody's marketing plan, and I'll, in my head, figure out what that cost. 8 trade shows. Okay, those things, 5-10 grand a pop. I'll go over their marketing plan, their financials, their marketing. There's no money for trade shows. Or it's the exact same amount every month, over and over and over. So stuff like that is just a tell, right? So just be aware of that. Always do a pitch video. Always do a pitch video. We watch them. We want to see what you look like. Remember, we're investing in the team. We want to see you. And even if it's you just staring into the camera on your laptop, that's fine, we don't care. In fact, it would probably be more credible if it was just you sitting in front of your laptop telling me about it than some fancy, I mean, if you go spend money on a production company to do your pitch video, I'm gonna turn you down instantly because you don't manage your money very well. Now, if you just happen to have it grabbed from a room like this and somebody videotaped you doing a pitch competition, perfect, great, you're out doing it, that's fine. All the things we've been talking about, valuations, run rates, all this stuff, there are slots for all these things. And if you don't put in your cash flow, right, we just assume you don't care. And if you don't care, we don't care. We'll move on. This is very much your resume. So you want to polish it as much as or more as you polish a resume. And best practices, if somebody says they're not interested, pull their access. You've heard about some bad actors who you take data and move it around. They are out there, meaning they take your data and give it to your competitor. Those people are out there. I don't like them. There's nothing I can do about it. AngelList is a very, very popular platform right now. I have made a few investments on AngelList myself. The fundamental is, without getting into the details, on AngelList, a fund can make an investment in your company of, let's say, $50,000 through AngelList. And then all the accredited investors on AngelList can join that deal as part of that person's investment. So the cap table will show Ventures Fund 42, $50,000. Ventures Fund 42 Angels, $300,000. They put all of us in one, Chris, if I get this wrong, please correct me, but they put all of us in one LC and allow us to invest as little as $2,000 a deal. This is like doing mutual funds. So for an angel, it's really a cool thing for me. Rather than writing 25 or 50K checks every time, which, you know, I don't have unlimited money and nor am I gonna put a lot in every deal, I can now spread over 20 or 30 deals versus doing one or two. To me, I think that's a better plan because I'm acting more like a mutual fund versus, I mean, anybody wanna go pick 3 stocks right now and ride them for 5 years with no ability to get out? Anybody comfortable with that in the stock market? Pick 3 stocks, don't touch them for 5 years, because that's kind of what angel investing is. We make a bet, we put money in your company, and we wait probably 4 or 5 years to see it come back. So AngelList is a new phenomenon. It is a very powerful tool. I have seen people raise very, very large rounds out there, and it's very nice to your cap table. When JD looks at your cap table, he sees 2 entries. And by the way, only 1 vote. If I remember right, the LC has no vote. That vote goes back to the fund. So now the fund manager, who's a pro, or hopefully a pro, and is credible because all these people are following them, is the only person with even anything to say. So the VC looks at it and goes, oh yeah, okay, that's fine. I'm okay with that. And the whole you've got 300 investors thing isn't there. So that's why it's so popular. It's a very well done piece of work. When they first launched, they had a letter from the SEC, literally on their website saying, the SEC saying, yes, we're fine with what you're doing. Which back in the early days of crowdfunding, that was a hard thing to get.
Yeah, especially when it's specific, because it's helpful.
Yeah, so And they're very tough on the people that go out there. When I signed up, I said, yes, I'm an accredited investor. The next thing I know, I'm uploading, or I'm actually having to connect them to my Merrill Lynch representative and signing a document allowing Merrill Lynch to disclose my financial data. It wasn't, we believe you, it was prove it. So again, their best practices on doing this. It is the de facto for syndicated financing rounds. Again, recruiting and fundraising tool, both. Lots of people out there. Yeah.
Can you kind of go through, doesn't some, like the lead person though, Angel, that's got this, what's the, isn't there like a first?
There is a lead.
Lead dog?
Right,
something?
It has to be a lead. So Paul Singh, I came through here about 6 months ago, does these quite a bit. He'll lead a deal. He's well known. You love him, hate him, doesn't matter. He's well known. And he has the fund. It is a fund. So AngelList makes sure that he's credible. He's got a fund. He has to get all that set up on AngelList through them. Then people follow him. So I follow his deals and I can pick which ones. I get a note whenever he's investing in something, I can pick. I have about a day or two to make my decision. It's a snapshot kind of deal. But yes, everybody that's leading is highly qualified and highly regulated by AngelList.
So as a startup, you've got to, part of it is finding the right person that leads. So if you get Paul, right, that's obviously kind of a slam dunk.
Yep.
If you get, you know,
he may not have any followers, but you can go to AngelList and figure out how many followers those guys have.
Do they have anybody in there that is domain specific? Like this person leads a lot of insurance deals, or this person leads a lot of...
You know, you can go out and search for that. I don't remember if that's in there, and I haven't been in there for a little while looking for new people to follow. I kind of have the group I follow and stuck with that. Tej might be able to answer that question better. He's in D.C. today, so unfortunately.
We just haven't ever looked at it.
Have
any of the other startups?
Well, but I know Paul Singh actually was going to do a round for one of the startups he met here while he was on his tour. He agreed to put a certain amount in, and then all of his followers look at it. And I don't know if he followed through, but that's a good example. If you just meet somebody, they may not write a giant check, but if they want to do it on AngelList, they might do a small amount and have their followers come in. And yeah, you still got to find the lead, as always. So for startups, really simple, complete, up-to-date, fresh. This is not writing a book. It's that one pager or less. Frequent reporting, videos, you've got to do that. I think that the thing that most people miss is the fact that it's a research tool. So I'll pick on Kaylee. I have no idea if Kaylee wants to raise money. Don't really care. She should be out there looking and see who's starting a company in her market. Every 3 months, you should be out there looking at who's starting a company in their market, because they may be trying to raise $5 million and have a really cool idea, but they're not in the market, so you don't see them competitively because they haven't got to the market yet, but they're on AngelList trying to raise the first round, trying to raise their seed round. It's a wonderful place to do research. It's a wonderful place to hire people. Sometimes there's a startup out there that has been kind of struggling and they've got a couple of really talented people you find out about. Maybe it's a way for you to connect with them, see if they want to come to work with you. So in the talent war we're in, and we're in a war of talent, it's a great place to go look for talent is the startups that aren't getting funded. I hate to say that, but it's true, right? If it's not working, it's not working, go hunt them down. So for investors, and I don't think there's a lot of investors in the room today, but just know that it's a social network for them also. So there are a lot of rules around it, so I won't spend a lot of time on this, but it's heavily standardized and it's very credible. So for you, are these good investors? I can tell you that on AngelList, it's very, very well thought of. They've done thousands of deals now. They've done a lot of deals. And it's the whole thing. I think there's a carry on are we gonna get into what carries are?
I don't think we are.
I'm going to hold that off. If you want to know more about how the funding works, I'll be happy to go. I don't want to go down that road. That's a long discussion. VC or a fund creates a lead. They create a single, the syndicate, we talked through that. First 98 members fill the round. That's a legal issue with having no more than 100 investors. You can't have, I don't know what the number is, but it's 100 or less. So that's one of the things that will happen to someone like me is they'll come out and say, well, we're raising enough. The minimum on this deal is 5,000 per angel. Minimum in this deal is 2,000 per angel. Minimum in this deal is 1,000. So as an investor, they do vary around. I've rarely seen them more than 5K each, because the whole idea is you're spreading your risk.
Mike, in regards to the closing in 2 to 3 weeks, is this a much faster way to get capital?
Once you get the lead, yes. I mean, if you can get somebody like Paul to post it, from the point it posts, you're going to see your close out very quickly. Sure. Yeah, because our capital call is like a 48-hour turn. So when I say yes, I only have about a day to get the money to them. So I actually have it connected already to my bank account, because I already know this is what's going to happen. A yes is a hard yes the second you click it. Yeah.
Does AngelList have more standard term sheets, or is it that the lead sets sort of
I believe the terms are relatively standard on AngelList. I believe they're all pretty well set, but I'm going to let Chris comment on that. Because
I think there's some variation, but I think that consistent with the overall process, the point of being able to move quickly is the standardization. So they're going to be pretty simple.
Lots of requirements on you if you do AngelList, and they will hunt you down. And I think this is one of those things that drives investors nuts, is when startups won't do their reporting, especially when it comes around taxes. I'm lucky if I can get my taxes done by July, because my startups will not send me the documents, will not finish their reports. And if you ever think you're going to get going with a VC, if you're stiffing your angels all the time on all the reports, the VCs will talk to us before they invest in you. And it's going to become a subject. It really does cause a lot of pain. So please, do your reporting. And on AngelList, I mean, they're very tough on hunting you down and finding you. They'll spend the time, so don't blow them off.
Mike,
questions?
Have you seen local entrepreneurs successful on AngelList?
Have I seen local entrepreneurs successful on AngelList? Yes. Unfortunately, I can't tell you who they are, because I'm not supposed to, but yes, I have. But it was because they knew a lead. So one of the chief technology people at Google that's in the lab somewhere, I don't remember his name, I've never heard of the guy, other than on AngelList, but there's a bunch of people over in Eastern Iowa I know the guy from 15 years ago in another industry, and they all believe in what he does, so they're all following him. And they are sending deals to him, and he's investing them, and they're all investing behind him. So they're actually using an old networking relationship. They've kind of built a following over in Cedar Rapids.
So there's a strategy of getting the lead. You haven't seen anyone just put it out there and it just magically happened.
I've seen people put it out there and got a phone call. Yes, because some of the small, like you said, the micro VCs and some of the angel groups that are, to Casey's point, right now, if you put an ag startup out there, you will get calls from ag VCs. I'm not saying it's going to lead a long ways, but they're hunting for hot deals. They're hunting. Now, if you're in a space that's not hot, if you're doing the next Facebook, you're not going to get any phone calls. That ship left a long time ago. So it's going to depend on what you're doing.
What is the scale of dollars that flows with these
companies? I've seen, as little as a couple hundred Ks at the small end. And I think we've seen some $1 million ones. But again, remember, you can only have 98 people in the fund. So you've got to divide that out and say 100 times 10,000 or 5,000. I think anything over 400K is very excessive. What it really is doing is giving you some traction early, especially if the terms are already set in the deal and you're just trying to fill it out. It's a nice, quick way to do it. But you're not going to raise, you might raise a seed round out here. That's a good place to do a seed round.
You had any experience with a follow-on investor, like a larger secondary Series A or Series B round, and the experience that they have with?
From what I've heard, follow-on investors are very happy with it. And a lot of the people that are leading deals out here and running seed funds out here are follow-on investors. It's their way of making an early investment. So if I'm Brad Feld, at one time Brad was very active on it, and he's doing very large-scale investing, he was using this as his really early stage entry point, because he could drop, if he really thought you had a good idea, his 25K isn't going to get you done. But if you need 300, his syndicate can get you 300. It's a great way for him to give you a vote of confidence. Here's your 300. Come back and prove it to me.
He's putting 25K.
But and he put 25K in and gave you the record. And by the way, he's on the hook for the due diligence. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously Brad's reputation goes to crap if all of his deals fall apart.
But typically on there, they're not lead investors, are they?
They lead on this. So
they don't have to be a lead on the
not necessarily. it gets a little, you got to be a little careful that, you know, if these guys are a follow-on investment to a lead, they've got to match it within the term set. Again, I go back to the lawyers at that point. Other questions?
Yeah,